for favor. This is my season to reap what I have sown. This is my season for grace, for favor. This is my season to reap what I have sown. Y'all listen at this. See, I haven't been perfect, but I sure been faithful. See, God's got a purpose, yes, and I know he's able. I've got to see in the ground that he's blessing, no more stressing. I've got to see in the ground, now I'm knowing and it's showing. I see for grace, for favor. It only works when we all do it.
This is my season.
To do what?
To reap what I have sown.
Come on, you say, this is my season.
For grace.
For what else?
For favor. This is my season to reap what I have sown.
Listen, everything is working together for my good. Say it, church. Everything is working. Don't feel good, but it's working
for my good.
Say it again, y'all. Everything is
amen, 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 amen. Yes, amen. Praise God. Everything is working together for my good. Praise God. Praise God. Amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hoo-wee. Thank God. There have been so many complications within the last half an hour. You have no idea. But I truly believe that somebody don't want this message to go forward. You are talking with the Barretts. I'm Pastor Michael Barrett. However, my other half is not here today. Shout out to my wife, Lakeisha Barrett. We were at Mount Moriah Church. Mount Moriah Church is on 42nd Street in Figueroa. That's where my wife and I got married. And they are there honoring Reverend Wade, his 40th anniversary. He's been preaching for 50 years. I mean, I didn't even want to come to the station, but I was like, one of us got to go to the station. So I just decided to come. So here I am. I parked there earlier, my wife and I and the kids, we parked earlier, and lo and behold, I'm coming out, and we blocked in. So I'm like, the devil is a liar. I got like 20 minutes to get to the station. I'm like, the devil is a liar. So the parking attendant, shout out to you. You know who you are. I believe your name is Darren. Byron, shout out to you. He was like, man, we're going to get you up out of here. So I was like, look, I got to rush to the radio station. So lo and behold, I had to just go off the sidewalk and weave through a little car. So we get to the station. The engineer, everything set. I sit down, me and my guests, who I'll introduce in a minute, and we sit down, and the computer just crashed. We reboot it, crashes again. Reboot it, crashes again. And we just dropped our head and says, Lord, take control, and by faith, we're coming to you. You're talking with the Barretts. I just want to pray and then go into the show today. God bless you. Heavenly Father, Lord God, I just thank you on today, Lord God, and just ask that you would have your will, God, that you would just glorify yourself through this message, Lord God. I thank you for the opportunity to be a blessing to your people, Lord God. Those who may have tuned off, Lord God, because they thought we weren't on the air, God, allow them to just get back on the air, Lord, and allow callers to call in. Allow you to be glorified, Lord. I just thank you and I bless you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, my wife is not here this evening, but I have Lakia here with me. And Lakia is my bonus daughter. She's 11 years old. You want to introduce yourself?
Yes. Hi, I'm Lakia Rambo. And I'm just blessed to be here. I'm blessed that my dad chose me and trusted me to be able to be here today.
Amen.
And I'm just really thankful. Thanks, Dad.
Amen. And she was like, soon as we left the church from Mount Moriah, she's like, Dad, can I fill in for Mom? Please, I got this. I'm telling you, I could do it. I'm like, just chill. on our way here. I said, okay, we'll see. You know, but today I really want to talk about an interesting topic. Yesterday I had the opportunity to go to Los Padrinos Juvenile Hall. Shout out to Nika Simone. Shout out to London. Shout out to AD, Silk. I'm trying to remember all the names. Terrence, if I forgot your name, forgive me. The staff there, Mr. Freeman, Miss Colors. I mean, it was just truly a blessing. We ended up in the chapel. They put a comedian, two comedians before me. I'm a preacher, and they put two comedians before me, and I'm like, now how is a preacher gonna go behind some comedians? And it all worked out. It was just such a blessing. Those guys were funny. You know, they exhibited their talents. But most importantly, everybody contributed their time and their gift to speak into the life of those youth. And when I mean that we had an awesome time, it was just such a blessing. See, a lot of times people go places and they look for recognition, but how often do they want to visit a prison, visit a hospital, a sick bed, visit somebody that's homeless? You know, there's no cameras, there's no media attention, but I just thank the talented and gifted people that just stepped up to the plate and helped our sister, Nika Simone, with the opportunity to speak to the youth. And there had to be over 200 youth present yesterday. And for me, it hit home. It was personal because I remember at the age of 15 years old being in a juvenile facility. I remember the days when my mother used to come up and drive all the way to Valencia, California. She used to drive all the way to Sillmore Juvenile Hall. She used to drive all the way to LP in Central Juvenile Hall just to visit her son. Her son, who was hard-headed, who was rebellious, who didn't listen, but at the age of 15, Mom was there, you know, and I'm so thankful for that opportunity. So on the way here, Lakia and I was talking, and we were talking about, you know, how did the youth get there? You know, what happened? You know, what transpired that caused them to go down that wrong path, you know, and Wednesday and Thursday, I spoke at a middle school and a high school. And here it is. I'm speaking to a middle school and a high school on Wednesday and Thursday, and I'm telling them about the visit for Saturday in hopes that my visiting the juvenile hall Saturday would deter them from any actions that they may have that may lead them to juvenile hall. You know, so it is my prayer and so many other people that's praying for these youth, you know, and I want to read a scripture. It's in the book of Proverbs, chapter 1, verse 8, and it says, "My son, hear the instruction of your father, and do not forsake the law of your mother. For they will be a graceful ornament on your head and chains about your neck. My son, if sinners entice you, do not consent. If they say, 'Come with us, let us wait to shed blood. Let us lurk secretly for the innocent without cause. Let us swallow them alive like Sheol, and whole like those who go down to the pit. We shall find all kinds of precious possessions. We shall fill our houses with spoil. Cast in your lot among us. Let us all have one purse. My son, do not walk in the way with them. Keep your foot from their path, for their feet run to evil, and they make haste to shed blood. Surely in vain the net is set and spread in the sight of any bird. But they lie in wait for their own blood. They lurk secretly for their own lives.'" And when I was reading that chapter and these verses, it really touched me because it is a form of just ministering to the youth. It's God is speaking wisdom, and he's saying, if sinners entice you, if your friends entice you and say, hey, man, look, come with us. Let us go shed some innocent blood. You know, let us put our purse together and have one purse. That's like, let's put all our money together, get a 40, get some weed. Let's do this. Let's do that. And when that comes about, God is saying that don't follow in those footsteps. Don't follow that path because it would lead to a path of destruction. And seeing those youth yesterday, it really touched me because I realized that something went wrong for them to be there. Something went wrong for them to be there. And I'm going to open up and allow my guest, I'm going to ask her a question. 11 years old, I believe she can handle the question. And Lakia, what do you think went wrong?
Well, the things that I think went wrong was, like, first, you don't never know what the people have been going through to be able to get into the juvenile hall.
Yes.
Like, let's say their parents, they're following their parents' footsteps. Their parents have done it, so they think that, oh, it's okay for me to do the same thing that my parents done. I'll just follow their lead. And also, they could be forced. Like, people could force them to do different things. I think it's painful to be forced to do what you don't want to do.
Yes.
But at the same time, they would threaten you, like, oh, if you don't do this, I'll kill your parents. Or if you don't do this, I'll kill your whole family. And you're like, I want to do this for my family. I want to do this for my family so they won't be dead. And so I just think that they would have to do it. And next thing you know, they like it. So they keep on going and keep on going.
So do you think, okay, you're in high school. And in high school, there is a lot of peer pressure, right?
Yes.
But as a leader, do you succumb to peer pressure?
Well, no. It's kind of hard to say because, you know, you're around high schoolers, and high schoolers think that since, you know, I'm bigger than you, you should follow my footsteps.
Yes.
Since you're littler than me, I should be able to tell you what to do. And some middle schoolers, they say, yeah, if you're bigger than me, you're like one of my big sisters. I might as well just follow what you do. Since, you know, you're right next to me, I'm always seeing you every day at school, so I might as well.
So it's fair to say that most youth follow what they see, right? Whether it be a good example or a bad example. And what happens is the leaders that they have before them may be setting a bad example. You know, an older brother, older sister, older, you know, friend or something like that. So what happens is you have to realize that you can't allow yourself to follow just anybody. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
And I tell you a lot, you know, for me, my children were grown when I came out of prison, you know. So now God has blessed me with you, which is a bonus daughter. And I say bonus daughter because when your mom and I married the family, you know, and she has four bonus daughters and I have two bonus daughters and we become a family. My daughters are grown, so I don't get the opportunity to spend with them as I do with you, you know, and in one sense, it may appear to be a bad thing in their mind because they don't get to do the things that dad is doing with you, but I still love them just as I love you, you know. So what happens is I believe within the household, a lot of times maybe a parent was missing, you know, like me. I grew up and my dad was in prison. So for my dad being in prison, I didn't have that father figure and I was the older brother. So for me, looking back, I say to myself, I looked at people that were older than me. And based on the things that they were doing, I found myself walking in their footsteps. And when I went to the juvenile facility yesterday, when we first got in there, and this is how I know these are some good kids. I mean, a lot of people make the wrong mistakes. But what happened was when we got in there, comedians were up there and they were cracking some pretty good jokes. And this one kid, he was in there. He was just so tough and you couldn't break him. And one of the comedians was like, oh, you one of them tough brothers, huh? You don't want to just laugh. You don't want to smile. You don't want to do nothing. And he had this look on his face like, if you say one more joke, I'm going to run up there and just do something to you. And I was the third one that spoke. And not to take no credit, but as I began to speak what God had put on my heart, By the time I stepped off that stage and went to sit down, the young man was in reach distance from me, and he just started crying, just pouring down, crying. And I just saw him, and I just kept praising God and thanking God because I knew the Spirit of God had touched him. And what happened was his counselor came to him and just asked, "Are you okay?" And he just could not stop crying. He took his sweatshirt and put it over his face, and they took him outside, and I asked, could I go outside with him? And I kneeled down with him, and I prayed with him, and I talked to him. And I just start speaking over his life, telling him, you're going to be all right. Everything going to be fine. Just hang in there. You know, he's facing some time. He goes to court on May 1st. And I just look, and I realize how we as a society, it's somewhat our fault too. The system is somewhat designed to keep the cycle going. And when you want to step up and break the cycle, you don't find too many people that want to join forces and form an allegiance with you and help. So yesterday to me was when a leader step up. Nika Simone to me was a leader yesterday. And she stepped up and she called out for a cause. And people joined in that cause. And collectively we came together to help the youth. And I truly believe that it's just the beginning of something far greater. Yeah. You know, and we were talking about that. And I'm still moved by what happened. Yeah. You know, because when I think about it, when I pick you up from school and all of those kids that I see walking back to school, from school, those are some of the kids that were in juvenile hall yesterday. Not necessarily the faces that I see at your school. Yeah. But I guarantee you that somebody from your school has gone through juvenile hall. And you might say, well, those are little bad little boys. But guess what? I didn't even tell you this part. There were little girls in there, too. Oh. 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. They made them sit towards the back. And all of the boys was to the front. And then you had the young men and the young women in there. And it's like, wow, that's somebody's daughter. That's somebody's sister. That's somebody's brother. You know, so what do you say about that?
Well, I didn't even know that there were.
I know. I held that out from you.
Yeah, I didn't even know that there were young ladies also. Yes. I just thought there were men, young men. Usually, it's usually just the men. That's just my opinion. Usually, I just see men in juvenile. And, like, usually I commit, like, oh, well, men are more troublemakers and then girls. But really, that's not the truth. They could both be troublemakers. Men could be more than girls. Girls could be more than boys. It depends on how the parents raise their children. And I'm glad my dad told me that there were young ladies inside of the juvenile hall. Because now I see that it doesn't matter what gender you are, boy or girl, you could still be in the same trouble. Yeah. You could still be in the same situation. And it was like, it touched me because, like, I never know. I say I have problems, but when I hear other people's problems, it's like, I don't have anything. Like, that's right. I'm cool. Like, I don't have any problems. But when I hear other people's problems, I'm like, wow, look at them besides me.
And you know, you know what? We're going to take a break. Few seconds, and then we're going to ask for some callers to call in. Hopefully you were still paying attention. We had a little blackout for the first maybe 10 minutes. Hopefully you tune back in and we can get some calls going. And if not, me and Kia, we just gonna keep it going. So let us get a commercial break. God bless you. We'll be right back talking with you. The Barretts.
I find favor in your sight, Lord, please hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting to be where you are. Across the hottest desert, I'll travel near or far for your glory. Do anything just just to see you, to behold you as my King. Lord, if I find favor, come and say, find favor in your sight.
We had to take a commercial break and give a little shout out to two of our sponsors, New Building Block, Miss Pat, Mr. Solomon. God bless you. You guys do a great job over at New Building Block Daycare. Lighthouse Praise Network, Pastor Bynum, God bless you. Continue to let the light shine. Blessings. If you want to call in, you can call at 323-965-1600. I'm hoping somebody called from the facility at the juvenile facility in Los Padrinos. That's 323-965-1600. Even if you're not at the juvenile facility and you're listening, you're tuned in, you can call if you have a child that may have been rebellious. You can call in and give us a little something that you may be dealing with or going through. Amen. So when we went to the facility yesterday, not only did we preach in the chapel, you know, I preached in the chapel, the comedians did what they did, but after that we had lunch, and they actually allowed us to walk into the housing units. And I never forget this one mother, she was sitting there with her son, and as I'm walking in the housing unit, and the officers are greeting us and stuff like that. And when they get visits, they actually, the parents come into the housing unit. It changed a lot since I was there because we would go to a different location. But they were sitting in, this one guy, he was sitting in there with his mom. And his mother said to me, she said, I just want to thank you so much. My son told me what you spoke about. And what I said was that when I was not listening to my mother, God was listening to my mother's prayers. You get that? When I was not listening to my mother, God was listening to my mother's prayers. And this woman spoke and she said, that's how her and her son is. He was not listening to her, but God was listening to her prayers. And prayer is very important. But yes, today it's like our youth are a little different. I never raised my voice at my mother. I never jumped up in my mother's face. I never threatened my mother to hit. What? Are you crazy? No way. I've never even cursed in front of my mother. Even when I was in the streets ripping and running, you know, when the prosecutor said that I was this big drug dealer and this happened and that happened, my mother was like, who? Not my son. Because I tried to keep everything that was bad away from her. It wasn't that I was trying to deceive her or anything. I just felt like I have to have the utmost respect for my mother.
Yeah.
You know, and today's youth, it's like that respect level for parents is dwindling. It's gone. Why is that? Why do you think that is? Come on, because you're a youth. You're 11 years old. This is kind of your age bracket. You know, what's going on? I ain't trying to put you on the spot, but what
kinda,
y'all doing? Y'all getting turned up. What's going on?
Okay, don't. You kind of did, but I don't know. I guess it's that you guys back in the olden days, you guys knew better to respect your parents. Not saying that we don't, but people these days in the new school, we just, I don't know. Usually, when I'm gonna tell you the truth, I do have my little attitudes, ups and downs with my parents, and I do apologize. Sometimes I'm not respectful, not as respectful as I should be. But I don't know. It's just sometimes kids have that moment where they don't. Sometimes kids have that moment where they like, why should I respect my parents? And I don't know, their parents. Not saying the parents don't, but the parents don't show the kids how they had to respect their parents. Mm. And back in the days where they had to respect their parents, and know any problems that you had, you still had to respect your parents no matter what.
Yeah.
If you had, let's say you had cancer, and you were surviving on your life, you still have to respect your parents. Like, you still can't cuss your parents out because you're going through so much.
Yeah.
You still have to respect your parents. And some parents, not saying you parents don't, but some parents don't
teach their kids how they had to respect their parents back when they were little, and how what they had to do if they didn't respect their parents back
then. Well, I think, too, you know, even, you know, I can go scripture on you, and the Bible talks about a generation that will be disobedient to parents and children raising up against their parents and stuff like that. But when I was at the school talking to the youth, I asked them a question, and I said, how do you think these young men and women got to the juvenile hall facility? And I was telling them, and they came up with some good answers, but I was telling them, I said, you know what? They didn't pay attention. They didn't listen. Because I'm sure there was somebody telling them, don't do this, don't do that. It's always a good voice in your ear, and then there's always a bad voice in the ear. Yeah. And sometimes we tend to listen to the bad voice. See, when I was younger, my mother used to tell me certain things, but I thought, oh, she don't know what she's talking about. She's not out here in the streets. How does she know that? She just
older. She don't know what I'm going through. Yeah.
But what happens is, she loves me so much that she's given me a warning in regards to what's out there.
Yeah.
So just like when I was talking to you, when your mom and I say certain things, it's not that we want to be mean or come down on you. We know what's best for you. And you might not be able to see that projection that we see. Well, why can't go outside? Well, today, mom might just get a feeling like, I think people she needs to stay in the house.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But guess what? That intuition, that gut feeling, just may be the thing that saves your life. So you don't know, you know? Well, clean up your room. You might say, well, why I got to clean up my room? It's my room. It should be able to stay how I want it. But no, because guess what? It's teaching you how to be clean as a young woman. It's teaching you some principles, you know? So everything in life, it teaches you something and you can learn from it. And that's just how, you know, that's how I see it, you know. And being in that unit yesterday and seeing those young men. And I one thing I realized, too, a lot of times when we're out and about in front of everybody, we put on that macho. But, you know, those young guys were hurting, you know.
Inside, but they didn't want to show it.
Yes.
They were trying to be strong outside. They were trying to be like, they were trying to be strong, not to cut you off or anything.
No, go ahead.
They were trying to be like, be like a person they want. They were trying to stand up for themselves.
Yes.
But the inside, they were hurting so badly. But the outside, they're like, I ain't going to show that in front of this man. Yes. What?
And then not only that, it was like close to 200 other juveniles in there. So had they shown a sign of weakness,
they thought they were gonna get beat
you know,
up.
Somebody might, oh, man, I saw you in there crying, so
them.
They got to act tough, you know.
Yeah.
But what happens is, in acting tough, like the young man, he couldn't act tough because guess what? Spirit of God touched him. So he had to just break down.
Yeah.
He had to just let it go, you know, and that's the blessing because he was able to just let it go versus trying to hold it all in. And a lot of times we don't know as parents, you know, sometimes we might miss the mark. You know, I have my youngest daughter who's 20 years old, you know, and we go back and forth. We go back and forth. At the end of the day, I love her, but I refuse to allow her to disrespect me. You see what I'm saying? But in all truth, she may be going through some things that I have no clue of. You know, she lives 3,000 miles away. So she don't have the relationship like we have. You know, we get to spend time. I get to drop you off at school, pick you up, go to functions and different things like that. You know, dinner is cooked. We're at the table as a family. So she didn't get that. So my thing is, I pray for her. I love her. But I also understand that sometimes, like you say, but Dad, you just don't understand. Or Mom, you just don't understand. That could be very well true. You know what? Because I don't know what's going on in your head. Only God knows that. So what I say is that sometimes, even as parents, we need to just take a deep breath and just listen and hear the child out. Say, okay, what is it? What's going on? What's really bothering you?
Yeah.
You know, and then we try to get to that and we try to solve it, you know, but it's not always solvable in one day or an hour. You know, it may take weeks, it may take months, but I refuse to give up. I just keep going and just keep speaking over the situation, praying about the situation. But what happens is we have to communicate. We have to be able to communicate. And what is that communication? Like, with you and I notice in this day and age, you know what a lot of things too? Technology. Because sometime I'm taking you to school and it's like, you're like this. And there's no communication, right? You're doing your selfie thing. Putting it on your Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, whatever you're doing. But for that 15 minutes that I have to take you to school, guess what? We could be talking about something productive. But sometimes kids get so caught up in social media and the technology that they miss the communication. You know, sometimes you at the dinner table and it's like, put the phone down. We don't care who you calling, who you talking to, who you FaceTiming. Put the phone down. Why? Because it's dinner time. It's time for us as a family to communicate. Right?
Yes, I'm going to stop you on that. Go ahead. I don't have... Okay, on dinner time, I don't have my phone. That's you and Mom having your phone.
You used to have your phone.
That's you and Mom having your phone on Facebook. Exactly.
No.
I know, on Facebook, exactly. And in the car, yes, I'm always on my phone having my little morning selfies. That is true. Because I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm not going to hold my back up, give you my little excuse. But really, for me and for other kids, I'm going to back y'all up. But really, we don't have anything to talk about in the morning. For parents and kids to communicate, it's kind of hard. Like, we don't really know what we need it. That's why I was telling you today when we were in the car. I need to learn some more stuff about you. I need you to learn some more stuff about me so we could communicate better.
But that's communication.
So when I'm in the car, yes, I don't really talk that much because I'm in my morning mood, I'm in my morning selfie, and it's like, honestly, I know stuff about you, but not as much as I need to know about you. So I don't really have that much stuff to communicate about you. Like, hi, Dad, how you been? What you been up to? Love you, bye. We have really good conversations. I'm not going to say that. We do. I enjoy my conversations with you, but I need to learn more stuff about you, and
but
you need to learn more stuff about me.
But communication. So when you put your phone down in the morning, instead of your selfies, say, you know what? This is dad and daughter time, you know? That's me and Mom. We communicate. Yeah, we be on Facebook, but we communicate with
Facebook,
each other.
Facebook all the time.
But we got to talk about the Barretts. We got to do things. We got to put things out there. But guess what? At the end of the day, we communicate. And communication is very important. So there could be a gap between the communication. You know, I know me and my daughters, my biological daughters, we have a communication barrier sometimes because of the distance, 3,000 miles away. One is in school, this one is at work, this one is over here, I'm out here. You know, life is just moving so fast, but there is no excuse. You know, there is no excuse. You know, I spoke to my oldest daughter today and my grandchildren, and I'm thankful for that. But I need to step up a little more and communicate a little more as well. So we're going to go to another commercial break. We'll be right back talking with the Barretts. I guess a few of you guys got scared off because it was a little blackout for 15 minutes.
Please
but
call.
Hopefully you'll call in and we can get a conversation going. God bless you.
Bye.
We'll be right back.
Be right back.
I almost
Amen. You're back talking with the Barretts. Got my co-host for this evening, Lakia, with me. For those of you just tuning in, my wife is at Mount Moriah Church. I was there with her. One of us had to sacrifice and leave. They're celebrating Reverend Wade's 40th anniversary. And yes. I mean to tell you, that church is packed. They're getting their praise on. Bishop Ulmer's preaching. It was just awesome. And I was like, I gotta leave. One of us gotta leave. So here I am, and Lakia filled in, and we just talking with the Barretts. If you would like to sow a seed into this radio ministry, you would like to sponsor us. We had the ads on, but you can also send your seed to Kingdom Tainment Media, P.O. Box 8136, Los Angeles, California 90008. That's P.O. Box 8136, Los Angeles, California 90008. And I definitely want to take the time out to thank Cynthia, my sister. She called last week and she said that she wanted to sow a seed to be able to have us donate some books to the institution. And guess what, sis? Those books were delivered yesterday. I personally delivered. I wrote in the book the unit, and the CO made sure that each unit got a book. That young man that I ministered to, I personally autographed the book, gave it to him, and it was just a blessing. Some of the youth were like, can I get one? I said, we're going to bring some more back. So I definitely, they gave me an open door thing where they was saying, look, we need you to come back, speak to the youth. We might need you to even preach on Sundays.
Amen.
So, I mean, look at God. You know, I didn't get a paycheck. None of us did. You know, it was just volunteer work. Yeah. But sometimes you just got to do things from your heart and just give back. And in return, God will bless you. And that's what yesterday was, us giving back and God just turned it around. Wait a minute. See how the small world it is. One of the comedians and I went to school together.
Wow.
AD. Shout out to AD. We went to school together. And we seen each other, and I was like, brother, look for me. But I just didn't, you know, we're talking about 20-plus years ago. I'm 43 now. And he realized that he and I went to school, losing our high school, 89, 90. I went there 88, 87, and he went 89 and 90. And he was like, call me today, got my number. He was like, is this Mike? You were preaching, Mike, and we just hit it off. So I'm looking forward to just getting some time in with them and talking about some positive things that we could do for the youth and just so many other things. But look how small this world is, you know. It was just truly a blessing. So I just thank God once again for the opportunity. Lakia, you want to share something before we go?
Yes, I'm really blessed to be able to to be on the show with my dad again. Thank you. And pray for me tomorrow. I'm going to be on a set live tomorrow.
That's right.
Hopefully I'll be able to be there and be able to be there on Tuesday also.
Tell them what show you're going to be on tomorrow.
I'm going to be on a show called Teachers. I've never heard of it before, but it's a show.
Okay.
We're gonna talk to them today. Pray over my sister, Kimora, and everybody. Pray over my mom. Sorry she couldn't be here today, but she's praising the Lord at the same time. And I just thank you for being able to come. Here's my sister, Kimora.
Why you say that?
Kimora.
Say
Why
hi.
Why you say my name?
All right.
Okay, so that's my sister, Kimora. We were thanking for everybody being here today. I'm just thanking for you guys be able to let me welcome myself on the radio show. And, yes, thank you.
You know, so, all right, you got your time. All right, you good? I'm fine. All right.
And then we have a challenge. You put
on
a challenge.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that. But what we need to realize is that when I was talking, we were talking about the youth and the opportunity to just have more mentors.
Yeah.
A mentor is somebody that can basically be a role model, be an example. And we're asking for more mentors to step up. You know, we really need that, you know, to just step up and just get in the game and just reach these youth, you know. We're believing, I know Pastor Bynum over at Lighthouse Praise Network, he works with inner city youth at 103rd and Grape. They have a facility over there right across the street from the Nickerson Gardens. So we're asking for sponsors, donors, just come on out and just help. And then he also has access to a ranch where we want to take the inner city youth to the ranch and get them out of the hood and just show them, you know, there's dirt bikes there and there's different things that they can do to take them out of the inner cities for a week, for a few days, just to show them, you know, that life is better than your environment. You know, you can't look at your environment and think that that's the only place that you can be, or that's the only thing that life has to offer. One of the comedians, you know, he kept reiterating how he grew up on 91st and Fig, but he kept taking you down the line and showing how he's then linked up with Chris Tucker and different comedians and different opportunities, HBO and different shows that he were able to be on, but he kept saying 91st and Fig. He said, so he came from here, but look where he's at now. And I believe that as long as we continue to pour into the lives of these young men and these young women and encourage them that they can be more than what they see, they can be more than their environment, they can be more than anything they can ever imagine, because sky is the limit. You know, you put God first, you put your family, you put your goals, your career, your sky is the limit. There's nothing you can't do when you put your heart and mind to it and you do it honestly, you know. So I'm just so thankful. I don't know if the phone's working or what. Can you check the line to make sure they're working? You know, because we definitely want the opportunity for people to call in and give their views on the show. We didn't get a call in today. However, we did have a challenge that we put out there, and the challenge was to go out and do a good deed, right? And we believe we have a winner.
Ooh.
We have a winner. And that winner is Stacy Olson.
Woo! Awesome.
Shout out to Stacy.
Shout out to Stacy.
That's one of my wife's best friends. Shout out to Stacy. She did win the challenge. She went out and she met a homeless man, and she didn't have no more of her packets to give him, right? So, you know, it's easy to say, well, I ran out, I don't have no more. Next time I come, I'll give it to you. Yeah. But what she did, she says, as she was bending down, she saw and looked over and she saw IHOP. So she paid for him to go to IHOP and she fed him. Yeah. So that's a blessing, you know. So shout out to you. We owe you a book. And we got a T-shirt for you, too, Lighthouse Praise Network T-shirt.
Awesome.
We're promoting Lighthouse Praise Network, 24-hour Christian television network here in the Los Angeles area. And so we just thank you. But I want to, again, to parents, this is us, that young man or that young woman, that young man or that young girl that you're raising, they may be in a dark place. You know, yes, they may have jumped up in your face and yelled at you and wanted to hit you. And you're asking yourself, why is my baby acting like this? Some of them, drugs have affected them. Just be straight up. alcohol, all this other stuff that they smoking. But then some of them lost their dad to the system. Some of them are hurting because of peer pressure in school and so many other things. So let's try to build a bridge that we can come over and they can come over and we can meet together. I'm saying this, but I need to also do this with my own children. You know, my older daughters, build a bridge so we both can just walk over the bridge and meet together on a common ground. You know, so again, I just thank everybody that came out yesterday and gave of their time, gave of their efforts, and just was there to be a blessing to the youth, you know. So we're going to go to one more commercial break, then we'll come right back talking with the Barretts. God bless you, and we love you. Be right back talking with the Barretts.
To be where you are, across the hottest desert, I'll travel near or far for your glory. Just to see you, to behold you as my King, for your glory, I will do anything, just to see you, to behold you as my King. Lord, if I find favor in your sight, Lord, please, Lord, please, hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting just to be where you are, across the hottest desert. Just say I'll travel near or far.
Yes, yes, yes. You're back talking with the Barretts. We have a caller calling in. Caller, what's your name?
Hey, what's going on? It's Nika Simone.
Nika Simone, how you doing? How you doing? I was waiting for you to call. I said, I hope she call in. Look, go ahead, talk. I done talked about you. How you doing?
Exhausted. And must have fell asleep up here, and then I was like, I woke up right now, like, oh, no.
Well,
I need to call in and definitely talk to you, man. How are you today?
I'm blessed. I was just talking about yesterday and awesome show that you put on and how you just brought everything together. I mean, God is so good, you know. Give yourself a plug and just talk about the program and what you did.
Man, it was a great show. Yes, I appreciate you for being involved. It was a great show because of y'all. Like, you can't fake being authentic. You can't fake living something that has boosted you to try to do something better.
Yes.
Yesterday at Los Virginos Juvenile Hall, I put on a comedy show / motivational, inspirational, you know, speaking event at Los Virginos Juvenile Hall called Stand Up in the Hall.
Yes,
we had of you, of course, who did. Your message was so powerful.
Praise God. Thank you.
Powerful, by the way, that if you're not working with kids, just that's where it was supposed to be. One word that I got just listening to you was, you know, we get so angry with why did this happen to me? And unfortunately, you know, we have to live out our consequences, but you didn't get bitter.
Yes.
You used it, and now you're doing what you're doing. So, yes. I mean, between you, we had comedian Slink Johnson, we had actor, comedian London Brown, we had Alfonso McCauley, actor Liana Mendoza, we had Terrence Delane, another great comedian, Chris Need, another great comedian. It was so many people there. It was great. The kids are still talking about it today. Staff is still talking about it today. And I just had to put it together because, like I said yesterday, they encouraged me to step outside of myself to go after my dreams after I was always told, no, you can't do that.
Yes, yes. And you currently work there, right?
Yes.
Yes. And I mean, you know, it's one thing to work there and get a paycheck, but to actually step outside of that and want to bring something back that's going to make a difference, I applaud you. My wife is not here tonight. We had some things going on at a church. It was an anniversary, and one of us had to sacrifice and come to the show. But I just had to get this message out because it was such a blessing yesterday to see the impact. Some of them laughed, some of them cried, and some of them just, you know, got a hug, you know. And it's really what it's all about, to give back. Stand up in the halls. You got my vote. Anytime you need me, I'm there.
Oh, we're going to do some things.
Okay.
That was just the first one. So
that's right. That's right.
I plan on, God, you told me to do it. It's a vision.
That's right.
I can't imagine, like you said, we can't imagine how he's going to do it and what he's going to do with it, but I can tell it's going to be great.
Yes.
So I'm just excited to be on board and doing it for him.
Yes. I really see that going far because I remember one of the comedians, he said, man, you had called him, and he just jumped up and was like, I'm there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's not like, oh, I need you to be here. I got $1,500 for you, and they're going to pay you. I mean, just giving yourself and your talent is such a blessing. And I saw how you just, you know, hauled everything in, and you was like, Pastor Mike, I was here to, like, 2 or 3 in the morning, I think you said, with the balloons. And I'm like, wow, look at this. You know, and shout out to your crew, the young ladies that helped you. But look at your just giving back. You know, so many, not to down no officers or anything like that, but I've been in the system. Some of them just go home, get the check, and that's what it's all about. And
definitely.
I respect that. Hey, but then you do have some that pour into the life of the youth, adults, and they say, listen, you can change, you know, and that's what you need. You know, we know those youth know they messed up and they're there, you know. So somebody need to come along and say, hey, in spite of the mistakes, in spite of the bad choices, in spite of the mess up, you can still make something out of your life. And that's really what Stand Up in the Halls is all about.
Not everyone feels that way. I'm telling you, you know, the devil's so quick.
Yes.
Just a few hours after the show, when I have someone basically, you know, say to me, you know, you're doing too much for them kids. They don't deserve what you just did.
Wow.
They're still going to be messing up. They're still going to be doing what they're doing.
Wow.
And he told me he used to work where I worked.
Yes.
And I eventually told him in that conversation, well, I'm glad that you're not working there anymore.
Amen. And you know what? You know what? To that individual, I say you're wrong. You know how I know you're wrong? Because when I was 15 years old, it was people like you, Nika, and my mom, and so many other people. See, a lot of times people don't understand. You can pour some water into something, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you won't see no growth. You come back the next day, pour a little more water, you still don't see no growth.
Definitely.
But guess what? As long as you keep pouring that water in there, one day you're going to see something grow. And that's how my life has been. You know, people kept pouring it in. Pouring it. And here I am today, walk the juvenile hall system, walk the federal system. And here I am today, pastor, mentor, motivational speaker, author of a book, talking about doing a movie on my life. Look, you can't tell me what God can't do.
Exactly.
So I speak to that person and anybody else that has that type of mindset and say, just get out of the way. And watch it work.
Thank you.
Come on. Come on, Nika Simone.
Hey, get out the way
and watch it work.
Yeah.
You know,
that's why you're not there no more. That's all I can really say.
Amen.
You're entitled to your opinion.
Yes.
I understand that, but that's why you're not working there anymore. You weren't supposed to be there.
Yes. Yes. There you go.
And good luck to you.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
All right.
Well, Ed, man, go ahead.
I appreciate you so much. I just wanted to call in before you guys got us out of there, and just I appreciate you. It was a great event.
Okay.
We'll continue to do more. Let's make it bigger, and let's get it done, because it just has to be.
That's right. That's right. Look, you do what you do, and hey, you got my connection, and let's do it. I'm in.
Yeah.
I mean, that touched me. I was sharing earlier, you know, the young man that just remember when we first went in, he was just so hard, and then
he just broke down,
you know. And I said, wow, you know, look how God worked, you know. So it's so many of them in there that just want to hear something that can lift their spirits up and give them some hope.
And I say to anybody, what I started up with listening to the voices, and there's so many different voices going on in our heads,
yes,
in our own heads, and also coming, you know, from us, from family, from friends, from, you know, coworkers or
yes,
schoolmates, you know, listen to the voices, because if we don't listen to the voices, somebody's going to miss out, because we're missing out on our purpose.
Yes, yes. I was also talking, and I'm going to talk to the CEO tomorrow about some things. Two CEOs I'm going to talk to. I can't mention their names,
wow,
but I'll talk to you
off
air.
Don't worry about it. Just know they business
men. That's right. One who I love dearly, my spiritual mom, and talk to them about alternative to prison, you know.
Yeah.
That's one aspect. Then also transitioning out of prison. You know, and that is when they get out, what's there for them? Let's stop the gang member from embracing them when they get out. You know,
yeah,
so let's have some transitional facility that they can go to versus back to the hood. It makes no sense. And then try to have an alternative, saying, okay, he's in school, he made a mistake, he's in 11th grade. If he can come to this school, then we can prevent him from going to juvenile hall, messing up his record. Let's give him a one last shot. And that's called a second chance.
Yes.
You know, and I believe that those two outlets, it can break a cycle. And that's what we need. We need to break the cycle, because guess what? The system is designed for black and brown to go down. So they
got
to keep their heads up. And we as individuals have to intervene and break the cycle. And that's what it's about.
It's about giving hope and belief back, because when
yes,
you see your four walls of your own reality, which is
yes,
life, you don't see anything else different. You think, well, this is where I'm at. That's where I'm supposed to be. I understand that other people have other things.
Yes.
But this is my life, and I was one of those people, and I had to realize, no,
I can have
better than this.
That's right.
I have to work for it.
You know, even as a preacher, you know, sometimes I get convicted, because it's like, okay, you stay in the four walls of the church, right? And you're
mm-hmm,
preaching just to the congregation there. So God has been telling me, go beyond the four walls of the church. And
mm-hmm,
yesterday, what we did, and how I go to the school out in Compton, and I speak to the middle school and to the high school, and
yeah,
how my wife, you know, we visit the hospitals, we visit. This is what ministry is all about. It's not just staying in the four walls of the church. So me, myself, I'm going wherever God sends me. If he tells me to go to another juvenile facility with you, guess what? I'm going. Keep my name on that roster now. look, I'm in.
After yesterday, you definitely coming every time.
I'm in. I just love you for the opportunity and just the friendship. You know, everybody had a good, cool vibe, and we had a good time, and the kids loved it. And it's something for them to lay down at night and say, you know what, those people love me. They cared enough to come visit me. Because when we went into those housing units, Nika,
okay,
a lot of them didn't have visits. Like, three or four of them did, and the rest of them was just sitting around. Can you imagine 15, 16?
I see it every week.
Wow.
And that's why
wow,
I said it before I got out of there. I always say this every night before I leave
wow,
the hall. You guys, those who got court tomorrow,
yes,
good luck. Those who don't, keep running your program. I
wow,
guarantee it will pay off. If
yes,
it's not today, it's going to pay off somewhere
yes,
in your life. I will see y'all tomorrow. Have you know?
Yes.
Good night.
Yes. That's right. And you know what?
Every night.
Let Mr. Freeman and Ms. Colors know. I was so many others that were just so warm. I said, thank you. And I'm looking forward to Ms. Colors mentioned to me about possibly coming in on Sundays to preach, my wife and I. I'm letting you know this, Nika. I'm up here right now. For it. Look, put the plug in. I'm there. You don't even have to ask. I'm there. She was saying, you know, they needed somebody to come in to do the Protestant services, and I would fit right in, and I'm there. You know, I already talked to my wife about it. She sings. She ministers to the women at the charter school we speak at. So, hey, we're here. We're available. Make the connections. And you
know what? You're going to come and bring in what that service needs. Because
yes, that's what Ms. Cullors told me. Yes.
The Catholic services, they be showing out.
Yes.
I mean, it's a full-fledged mass going on.
Wow.
And you see the difference in the Protestant services.
Yes.
And if we're going to be walking, saying we about God, we gotta show
right.
that effort as well. So I know you would put the effort that needs to be there.
Listen, I'm
to
telling
touch
you.
Them kids.
Bring it in. And then also, and I know you know you got to get ready to go, but I spoke to the CEO of Lighthouse Praise Network. He has a television network, 24 hours, 7 days a week. We can get a film crew in there. We can get footage on TV. We could really bring this to the forefront and come with a solution that's going to solve the problem or at least help in some areas that can make a difference.
That's what I said, because all kids are the future.
That's right.
So that's why we can't just have the mentality they're never going to do anything
That's
with
right.
themselves anyway.
Well, let's invest in the future.
Definitely.
Amen.
I appreciate you so much. I have mad love for you.
God bless
it's
you.
It's the friendship that's for life now, so
Amen.
Just know it.
Amen. God bless you, and thank you so much. You have a blessed evening.
You too. Tell your wife I said, hey, I'm looking forward to meeting her.
We'll
person.
Do. We're going to come down and surprise you one day for your show and support you.
Yes. Thanks. Even Thursday or Friday, we're doing a double header this week. So
okay.
This Thursday and Friday, 10 to 11:30 p.m.
Okay.
Let's do it.
All right. Got you. God bless you. I'm going to call you, and we're going to hook that up.
All right.
All right.
Thanks so much.
God bless
Bye.
You. Take care.
You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Well, everybody, you know, I thank Ms. Wells giving me a little extra time. We did have a little computer glitch earlier. You talking with the Barretts. I'm just one Barrett tonight. My wife is out. She's at Mount Moriah Church getting her praise on and celebrating with Reverend Wade in the church. But I do want to say thank you so much for tuning in to Talking with the Barretts. And yes, as Nika Simone said, our youth are our future. And we need to pour into their lives. We need to step back. And we need to know that there is a problem going on. And we need to address the problem. I love you. God bless you. Talking with the Barretts. Tune in next Sunday, 6:30, same time, same channel. God bless you.
Sing a new song. All right. Put your lighter in the air for love.
Oh,
it's beautiful. Beautiful.
Oh.